Good artists borrow, great artists steal. Pablo Picasso. Don't take the word steal literally. This isn't a video on Picasso's semantics, but he meant steal in the form of remixing or putting a contemporary spin on established art forms. It was hyperbolic and ironic of him to use the word steal. This is how Latin America's catchiest song was a fraud. Testing 1, 2, testing 1, 2. If you were alive during the early 90s, you might have recognized that melody in the introduction, even if I slowed it down for dramatic effect. If you don't remember or don't know anything of what I'm talking about, let me play you a few seconds of a song to jog your memory. If you still don't know or remember, let me now play you two other songs. Two Frenchmen thought it was a catchy melody and wanted to capitalize off of it, and boy did they. But at what cost? This is a tragic story of how two Latin American bands were used by two greedy men, and why copyright law, with all its contemporary flaws, is still important to preserve to this day. Now let me play you an excerpt of this song. A Bolivian group, Los Carcas, came up with this song in 1981. It's called Llorando Se Fue, or He or She Left Crying in English, whose songwriters were two brothers in this group, Ulises and Gonzalo Hermosa.
Yo soy el autor y el compositor murió ya, Ulises.
Hermano menor de Hermosa.
Sí. Ajá, o sea. Yo soy hermano mayor de los Hermosas y él es hermano también mío.
It's not similar. It has the same exact melody that was used by Lambada, Taboo, and On the Floor. For context, Llorando Se Fue has nothing to do with sensual dances, Fast and Furious, or dancing on a floor. It has to do with loss, grief, and a broken heart. I, along with many others, including the composers themselves, have gripes with the bastardization of the original song.
A mí nunca me gustó. Nunca. No estuve de acuerdo. Por eso es que nunca aprendí a bailar lambada. No aprendí a bailar lambada, creo que a ninguno de nosotros, porque ese es un recuerdo melancólico de que alguien amaba mucho y que se fue. Y se fue llorando, no fue las condiciones más lindas, no fue un adiós cualquiera.
However, the focus of this video is with the plagiarism that played out with the creation of the 1989 hit Lambada, not with Llorando Se Fue's bastardization, which arguably goes back even further to the 1986 Sickly Sweet cover by Marcia Ferreira. Granted, artists are allowed to do covers of songs and transform them in their own way. Music and art in general are usually a derivative from prior works. If artist Y leaves a proper credit and they pay licenses to use a song's melody or chord progressions from artist X, they should be fine. Marcia Ferreira, Don Omar, and Jennifer Lopez did this. Heck, even I made a cover of Llorando Se Fue. However, Kaoma, the creators of Lambada, didn't do any of this, and they pay the consequences literally. So what even is Lambada? Before contemporary lambaderas, lambada dancers, or even lambada lovers come after me, lambada was and still is a genre of music before it became a dance and a hit song. Lambada, according to the American Lambada Organization, quote, is said to have been coined by Roldo Caracciolo, a radio broadcaster from Brazil, around the 1960s. Lambada means whip or punch, for music he thought had a kick to it like a shot of cachaca, a Brazilian rum, end quote. Two notable musicians started the trend of popularizing lambada across Brazil. Master Vieira, quote, who recorded Lambadas das Quebradas in 1978, and Master Pinduco, who began to combine beats and sounds that had arrived in Brazil with African people with those from nearby countries and island nations, especially Guadeloupe, Martinique, and South American countries. Early lambadas were a blend of cumbia, choro, merengue, and carimbo called guitarrada, inspiring people from Belém and further south to dance to them in a simple fashion, using the influences of their own backgrounds. Maxixe, carimbo, and lundu from Africa, cumbia and merengue from South America, polka that had come from Europe, and forró that was already popular in Brazil, end quote. Initially danced in Porto Seguro's nightclubs, it faced criticism for its sensuality but gained massive popularity in Brazil during the 80s. The Dos Santos brothers and Rebeca Rolang introduced innovations, leading to structured competitions and various lambada schools across Brazil. Here enter two Frenchmen, writer and director Olivier Lorzac and music producer Jean Caracos. They see an opportunity when they hear this popular sensual music from Brazil, and they think of commercial success, so they decide to exploit it. In April 1988, both men meet in Brazil. They buy a cassette copy of the 1986 cover Chorando Se Foi by Marcia Ferreira, with lyrics translated from the original into Portuguese. Quote, Lorzac is in charge of filming and advertising a music video in Porto Seguro, Bahia. Caracos buys the rights to almost 400 lambadas for Ediciones BM, the publisher they owned, all for USD 200 to $300,000, which is around $500,000 to more than $750,000 today adjusted for inflation. As if that were not enough, they register the term lambada in the Property Institute in France, with numbers 124263 and 135748. End quote. In other words, they were trying to trademark a genre of music, package it up, and market it to a Western audience that had greater spending power and disposable income than people in Brazil and other Latin American countries at the time. The chosen package would be Kaoma, a group that was comprised of Lala Brass, who was hired to sing lead vocals, Chico Drew, bass, Jackie Arconte, guitar, Jean Caracos, keyboard, also Chico and Roberta were the two Lambadeira kids in the group. This was all orchestrated, quote, in Paris by the Caracos-Lorzac duo on the eve of summer 1989. Both men would get the support of the first French television channel TF1, then the sponsorship of a popular soft drink brand, Orangina, which finances the filming of the video clip and its broadcast 250 times between July and August of that year. Lambada also had the backing of a record company with a strong presence in the international market at that time, CBS Records, end quote. The Lambada song became incredibly popular. The single sold 5 million copies in 1989 alone, a record for CBS Records, pun not intended. However, its peak was short-lived as Lambada faced backlash by most of the world that knew of its plagiarism, and Kaoma got embroiled in a lawsuit with the Bolivian group Los Carcas, which Carcas won in the end. This newfound popularity took a toll on one of Llorando Se Fue's composers, Ulises, who later in 1992 died of leukemia even after they won the lawsuit. He was 35 years old. During the time of the lawsuit, Oliveira claimed the melody was created by an anonymous composer, Chico de Oliveira, which turned out to be himself, who obviously didn't. Putting a part of your name in a pseudonym has got to be an all-time stupid move in the history of plagiarism. A conclusion for lambada as a genre and a dance is that it eventually declined in Brazil, which was exacerbated by negative portrayals into Hollywood flops that portrayed it as quote-unquote a forbidden dance. Religious objections and arson further tarnished its image in Porto Seguro and other parts of Brazil. However, lambada communities thrive globally, especially in Spain, Israel, and the USA. In the US, teachers like Master Brass and Shani Mayer helped establish lambada schools. Today it continues to evolve, with new steps and variations worldwide, maintaining its risque image. I do sympathize with the lovers of the lambada genre and the lambadeiras whose reputation was hung for a while by the infamy of the hit song. I even get that the song was catchy and well produced. I admittedly used a drum sample from it for my own single, Dancing Peace. A conclusion for copyright law is that, as with most things government-related, it takes time to amend laws. My unclimactic take is that we should maintain copyright law as is, but incrementally modify it so that bad actors don't abuse it. I previously shared the same opinion as a popular independent artist, Ben Jordan. He vents certain stances I previously held around the fact that copyright law should be abolished. This might seem revolutionary, extreme but appealing at the same time, and sure it was to me at first. However, I stress that we should be careful what we wish for. The abuse of copyright law in today's day and age is a problem. I don't deny this. These days it's common to see social media toxicity and clout chasers. There will be those people trying to copyright non-exclusive samples or claim a simple chord progression is theirs. That's an extreme. So I get the appeal of a counter-extreme. But abolishing a law that has helped people in the global south against people in the global north from exploiting them is a slippery slope. In this case, it was European copyright law that helped Los Carcas rather than US copyright law, but I hope you get my point. This case of Lambada versus Llorando Se Fue wasn't the only one where a song was appropriated for a Western audience. CBS Records also helped tarnish El Condor Pasa, another Andean composition. After globalization, a lot has changed, and so has music accessibility, and with that, the risks of cultural appropriation. If a songwriter wants to copyright their composition, they should be more than welcome to. But this brings up an important question. How do we meaningfully solve this issue of copyright? Well, there isn't a simple solution. My general opinion would be to transform the music industry to not pit artists against one another. This all comes down to capitalism that pits creatives against one another. It pits brands against one another. And that's the problem. The music industry wants you to become a brand rather than an artist. Sure, Western music has 12 notes to a scale and 12 scales in the circle of fifths. There's bound to be overlap in chord progressions and melodies, especially in pop music where melodic and chord variability is so low. The genre of pop is where, as you can imagine, most litigations happen. However, the Carcas Kaoma case was an ethical use of copyright infringement. Blatantly appropriating a group's music and melody for your own gain is ethically wrong, and involving unaware participants and tokenizing them in this money grab is doubly wrong.